Hello, in this video we will talk about the combined effect of different drugs. First we will take a quick overview of all possibilities, and then go into detail about each one. Let's get started. When we combine two drugs, there may be no interaction, or the total effect may be increased or decreased. There are three mechanisms that increase the effect: summation, additive effect, and synergism. Synergism can be achieved by sequential block, or when one drug alters the pharmacokinetics of the other drug. The decreased effect, or antagonism, can be chemical, physiological, or pharmacological. Pharmacological antagonism may be competitive or non-competitive. Subtypes of competitive antagonism are reversible and irreversible. And mechanisms for non-competitive antagonism are modulating the allosteric site, or events downstream to the receptor. So this is an overview. Now let's go into detail about each one. First, increased effects. Here first we have summation. In this, two drugs produce the same response, but with different mechanisms. And their combined effect is equal to the algebraic sum of individual effects. For example, combining aspirin and codeine for analgesia. Aspirin inhibits prostaglandin synthesis and thereby produces analgesia. And codeine stimulates opioid receptors, which also produces analgesia. Now let's say the analgesia produced by aspirin is this much, and that produced by codeine is this much. Here the analgesia with combination would be this much. Thus both drugs act by different mechanisms, but produce the same effect. And the combined effect is the sum of their individual effects. This is called summation. Now let's talk about the additive effect. In this, two drugs produce the same response with the same mechanisms. Here also, their combined effect is an algebraic sum of individual effects. For example, combining paracetamol and ibuprofen for analgesia. They both inhibit prostaglandin synthesis. Thus the mechanism is the same. And of course, the combined analgesia is equal to the sum of individual effects. So this is an additive effect. Now synergism. In the previous two mechanisms, the combined effects were equal to the algebraic sum of individual effects. But in synergism, the combined effect is more than the algebraic sum of individual effects. This can be achieved by two mechanisms. The first mechanism is sequential block. In this, both drugs act on different steps of the same biochemical pathway. For example, sulfamethoxazole plus trimethoprim combination on the pathway of folic acid synthesis. Here, sulfamethoxazole inhibits folate synthase, and trimethoprim inhibits dihydrofolate reductase. If used separately, they act as bacteriostatic drugs. This means they only stop the growth of bacteria, but don't kill them. However, when they are combined, the sequential block produces a bactericidal effect. This means it kills the bacteria. So this is a sequential block. Synergism can also occur when one drug alters the pharmacokinetics of the other drug. For example, when we give levodopa alone in Parkinsonism, the effect is negligible, because most of the levodopa is degraded in peripheral sites. So very less of it enters the CNS to produce an effect. But if we combine it with carbidopa, the carbidopa prevents its peripheral degradation. So most of the levodopa enters the CNS and produces the effect. Thus, with carbidopa, the effect of levodopa is significantly increased as compared to when it is given alone. Thus in synergism, the combined effect of two drugs is more than the sum of their individual effects. So these were all the mechanisms where we see an increased effect. Now let's talk about antagonism. Here one substance decreases the effect of the other one. Practically speaking, in these cases, only one is an actual drug. The other is usually our endogenous molecule, or sometimes poison, whose activity we want to decrease. As we saw earlier, the antagonism may be chemical, physiological, or pharmacological. In chemical antagonism, one substance is simply a chemical antidote for the other one. In simple words, they fight and neutralize each other, even without the involvement of any living thing from our body. For example, gastric acid versus antacids, heavy metals versus chelating agents, heparin versus protamine, etc. Antacids, being basic, neutralizes gastric acid. Chelating agents form inactive insoluble complexes with heavy metals, which decreases their effect. And highly positively charged protamine neutralizes strongly negative heparin. Thus, in chemical antagonism, the interaction between two substances is purely chemical. Next is physiological or functional antagonism. In this, both substances act by different mechanisms, but their ultimate effect is on the same physiological parameter, in opposite direction. For example, histamine versus adrenaline, on the tone of bronchial smooth muscle. Histamine acts on histaminergic receptors and produces bronchoconstriction. And adrenaline acts on adrenergic receptors and produce bronchodilatation. Thus, they both are acting by independent mechanisms. And they produce the opposite effect on the same physiological parameter. Thus, adrenaline is a physiological antagonist of histamine. Similarly, glucagon and insulin are also physiological antagonists of each other. Glucagon acts on glucagon receptors and increases blood sugar levels. And insulin acts on insulin receptors and decreases sugar levels. So this was physiological or functional antagonism. Now the pharmacological antagonism. It's also called receptor antagonism. It can be competitive or non-competitive. The fundamental difference between competitive and non-competitive antagonism is that, in competitive antagonism, the agonist and antagonist compete for binding with the same site on the receptor. Whereas in non-competitive antagonism, the agonist and antagonist bind at different sites or different molecules. So there won't be direct competition between them. Now let's talk about competitive antagonism. It can be of two types, reversible or irreversible. As per the name, we are going to have a competition. So let's bring the players and the playground of this competition. These are agonist molecules, and these are antagonists. At the bottom, we have a cell and receptors on its surface. This bar here shows how much response is being produced by the receptors. In reversible antagonism, the antagonist makes a weak bond with the receptor. So the binding is reversible. Of course, in absence of antagonists, the agonists can occupy all the receptors, which produces the maximum response. But if an antagonist is present, it competes with the agonist for binding and displaces some of them. This decreases the response. Now comes the key feature of reversible antagonism. At this point, if we increase the concentration of the agonist, the antagonists are displaced due to their weak binding. And the maximum response is achieved. Thus, it's a reversible antagonism. For example, atropine versus acetylcholine on muscarinic receptor. Acetylcholine is an agonist and atropine is a reversible competitive antagonist. So this was reversible antagonism. Now let's talk about the irreversible antagonism. In this, the antagonist binds with a strong covalent bond. So the binding is irreversible. Here, even if we increase agonist concentration, the antagonist is not displaced because of the strong bonding. So maximum response cannot be achieved. Or in other words, the antagonism is irreversible. For example, dibenamine is an irreversible competitive antagonist of norepinephrine at alpha-1 adrenergic receptors. If the idea of reversible and irreversible antagonism is clear, let me talk about an interesting concept, pseudo-reversible antagonism. Basically, it's irreversible antagonism, but at lower antagonist concentrations, it shows features of reversible antagonism. For certain physiological responses, occupying only some receptors is enough to achieve maximum response. So we have spare receptors. In such cases, the irreversible antagonism is not seen in its classical form. What happens is, the antagonist displaces the agonist and decreases the response. Now initially when antagonist concentration is low, if we increase the agonist concentration, they occupy spare receptors. So we can still achieve maximum response. Thus far, it's similar to reversible antagonism. However, with increasing antagonist concentration, more and more receptors are occupied by them, and eventually, spare receptors are also blocked. Now, even if we increase the agonist concentration, the maximum response cannot be achieved. And thus finally, it turns out to be irreversible antagonism. This is called pseudo-reversible antagonism. For example, phenoxybenzamine is a pseudo-reversible antagonist of alpha-1 receptor. So this was about competitive antagonism. Now let's talk about non-competitive antagonism. As I said earlier, the agonist and antagonist do not compete for same site in this type of antagonism. There are two mechanisms for this. One is binding at the allosteric site. An allosteric site is a site different from that where an agonist binds. This binding produces conformational changes in receptor that prevents the activity of the agonist. The second mechanism is by interfering with downstream events. For example, norepinephrine activates alpha-1 receptors in vascular smooth muscle cells. The series of downstream events include the opening of calcium channels and the entry of calcium. This produces vasoconstriction. Now, verapamil blocks the calcium channel and thereby prevents vasoconstriction. So verapamil can be said to be a non-competitive antagonist of norepinephrine. I think this is too far-fetched, but it's interesting to know all the possibilities. Okay, so these were all the effects of combining drugs. Now let's have a quick summary. In summation, the two drugs act by different mechanisms, and the combined effect is equal to the sum of individual effects. In additive effect, both drugs act by the same mechanism, and the combined effect is the sum of individual effects. In synergism, the combined effect is more than the sum of individual effects. This can be achieved by sequential block, where two drugs act on different steps of the same biochemical pathway. Or when one drug is altering the pharmacokinetic profile of the other drug. In chemical antagonism, one substance neutralizes the other, purely by chemical means. In physiological antagonism, both substances act by different mechanisms and produce the opposite effect on the same physiological parameter. Pharmacological or receptor antagonism can be competitive or non-competitive. In competitive antagonism, the agonist and antagonist compete for the same binding site. In reversible competitive antagonism, the binding of the antagonist is weak, so by increasing agonist concentration, the maximum response can be achieved. In irreversible antagonism, the antagonist binds with a strong covalent bond. So binding is irreversible, and maximum response cannot be achieved, even with increasing agonist concentration. In non-competitive antagonism, the antagonist does not compete for the same site as the agonist. It can be achieved by binding to an allosteric site on the same receptor molecule, or by interfering with the downstream signal molecule. That's it for this video. You can find notes and explore our entire animation video library on our website. The links are in the description. If you liked this video, please share it with your friends and colleagues too. And don't forget to subscribe because lots more to come. At Nonstop Neuron, learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. Thanks for watching, see you in the next video.